Welcome to the lecture on surveying. In today's lecture, we will continue the discussion on curve. In previous lecture, we were discussing our simple circular curve. We have already seen the methods of setting the simple circular curves by some of the methods like curve reduced method, as well as we have discussed setting of simple circular curve by rectangle method and last by two-thirds-length method. In today's lecture, we will solve the numericals using these methods. This question we have already discussed in the previous lecture. So here, in today's lecture, first of all, we will start learning the setting of simple circular curve using the curve reduced method. We are asked to calculate, we are asked to set simple circular curve using the curve reduced method. Parent level here, then we are asked to take the data from the question number 1 and one more information is given, that is parent level is 20 meter. So this was question number 1. Here we have already calculated these strengths, we have already calculated these parameters, that is tangent distance, length of the curve, change of point of curvature and the change of point of tangency. Before starting the setting of simple circular curve using curve reduced method, we will be required these 4 data, that is the tangent distance, the length of the curve, change of point of curvature, change of point of tangency. This we have already solved in the previous lecture. So we will take this data directly from there. So I take the change of point of curvature, that is change of point T1, directly as from the previous question, that this was 1357.51. And the change of point of tangency, that is T2, this was 1420.34. This we have already calculated. From here onwards, we will start solving this simple circular curve using curve reduced method. We represent these by C. And we will provide two subchord, one at the starting of the curve and another one at the ending of the curve. Here generally we provide a C1, this will be the Cn. So these are the subchords. They are the subchords. So what is subchord? The length of subchord is not equal to the length of subchord is always lesser than the length of normal chord. The length of normal chord is equal to the pair intervals. If this is 20 meter, it can be 30 meter. If this is 20 meter, the length of normal chord will be 20 meter. If the pair interval is 30 meter, then the length of normal chord will be 30 meter. Why we are introducing this concept? Because the lever what we use on this side for setting of simple circular curve is used to they are in a non-skilled lever. So non-skilled lever. So we want a full pair interval points like 1420, 1430, 1360, 800, 900. 1821 for any kind of, so we want the full pair interval on the curve. But as we have already calculated here, we can see the changes of point of curvature is 1357.41. That is not a full interval point. So we will try to calculate the full pair intervals where the pair interval is given as 20 meter in this problem. So we will divide this curve into an equivalent pair interval, that is 20 meter. The distance this will be 20 meter. We will try to keep this as also 20 meter. We will try to keep this as also 20 meter. This as also 20 meter. So these will be called the normal chords. While this first one, this will not be equal to 20 meter. So what we will do? We will try to find out this length of these subchords. So let's calculate it. The first length of first subchord, that will be for this point is the change of this point T1 is 1357.51. There is straight. We will try to find out next immediate higher number of this, that is multiple, that should be the multiple of 20. What we want to do, trying to find out the next immediate prime numbers which must be the multiple of 20. The next immediate prime number which is multiple of 20 is 1360. You can see here that after the next immediate prime number of 1357.51 is 1360. This is 1360 is fully divisible by 20. So we can keep this point, we can tag as 1360, that is full, that will be full pair interval. So if this is 1360, then this will be the length of first support. So how we can get this length of support? This will be 1360 minus the point of tangency. So this will give us the length of first support. This will be C1. This will be equivalent to 2.49 meter. Then similarly we can calculate the CN, that is the last support, the genus of point of this tangency, that is C2. That is 1420. So here we are trying to find out next previous immediate number which is the multiple of 20. Here we can see the immediate previous number which is the multiple of 20 is 1420 only. The 1420 is fully divisible by 20. If the pair interval is 30, then this number should be a multiple of 30. So here this will be 0.34. This will be the length of last support. Now we will try to find out the number of chords, the number of normal chords, that is n, number of normal chord, that is n equals to, this will be this 1420 minus this point, that is 1360 divided by 20, that is pi interval. So this will give us the number of normal chords. So if we will solve this, we will get the number of chord as 5, as 3. While we are doing this, we have calculated C1, so we are at this point, that is 1360, as well as we have calculated the Cn, that is this point. So we want to find out the number of chords in between this. The chain of this point is 1360, while the chain of this point is 1420. The pair interval is 20. So what we will do? We will subtract this minus this and we will divide it by the pair interval. So we will get the number of the normal chord. So if we solve this, we got the number of chords as normal chord as 3. But apart from that, we are using two subchord, that is C1 and Cn. So total number of chords. Total chords are 3 plus 2 equals to 5. Now we calculate the length of chords, that is C1. So C1 is what? Here we can use the formula for the Cn, that is here, that is the total number of chords are 5. Here we can say that C2 will be 20 meters, C3 will also be 20 meters, C4 will also be 20 meters. So these all will be the 20 meters. Now we will calculate the length of offset. What is the formula we use for offset? Offset is nothing but On equals to Cn into Cn plus Cn minus 1 divided by 2R. So here if by using this formula we will calculate the offset. So if you want to calculate the offset number 1, this will be On equals to Cn plus Cn plus will be C0 divided by 2R, where C0 does not exist, so this will be equal to 0. So I can write this as C1 square divided by 2R. The C1, this will be equal to the length of first support, that is 2.49 meter. So we will calculate this. O1 equals to C1 square divided by 2R, where C1 is 2.49 square divided by 2 into R value, this R is 100, so from this we will get the length of first support, length of first offset, this will be 0.031 meter. Similarly, we will calculate the O2, the O2 will be C2 into C2 plus C1 divided by 2R, where the C2 is nothing but 20 meter and C1 is 2.49 meter. If we put all these things, we will get the value of O2, that is oxide number 2. This will be 2.249 meters. Then we will calculate the O3. O3 will be C3 into C3 plus C2 divided by 2R. Here we can say that C3 is equal to C2, that is normal fault, and these are equal to 20 meters. So if you have solved this, I will get the O3, that is oxide number 3, as 4 meters. So from here, this will calculate the O4, that O4 will be equal to O3, because what will be the formula for O4? This will be the C4 into C4 plus C3 divided by 2R, where C4 is equal to C3 and Ola is equal to Ola 20 meters. So O4 will be equal to the O3. I will put directly. So after this, I'll calculate the O5. What will be O5? This will be C5 plus C4 divided by 2R. Yes, C4 is 20 meters, but the C5 is, you know, its last support, that is C5 is 0.34 meter. This is Cn is equal to C5, because total number of poles are 5 only. So here C5 is 0.34 meter and C4 is 20 meter. So if we will put all this value, we will get O5, that is oxide number 5. This will be 0.034 meter. So like this, you can calculate the offset as well as the cone length. At last, we can make a table and we can represent the data. Let's see the question number 3. What we have asked? We have asked for the data given in question number 1. We have asked to set a single circular curve using the right hand method. So, first of all, the length of this, the tangent distance, then the length of the curve, changes of point of curvature, the changes of point of tangency, we can calculate as we have calculated in question number 1. After this, we have to calculate the number of, we have to find out the length of first support, then we have to find out length of last support, as we have solved this in previous question, that is simple circular curve. So, setting of simple circular curve, using Cohn-Mediwes method in the similar way, we have to calculate the length of supports in the similar way. After that, we have to find out the number of poles, the number of normal poles and total number of poles. Up to this, the solution will remain exactly same as we have solved in previous problem. I am not solving just because we are setting the simple circular curve for the same data. So after this, the change that will be the calculation of deflection angle of the core, that will be there, that is there. So we will solve directly for the deflection angle. We can use the formula for deflection angle, that is delta n equals to 1718.9 into Cn by R where CL is what? CL is the length of core. So we will similarly in the previous we got the total number of cores as 5. So we will calculate the reflection into del 1. So here del 1 will be 1718.9 into C1 by R, where R is nothing but 100. What is C1? C1 is length of first subcord. So C1 was 2.49 meter. So if we do this, we'll get the del 1. This will be 42.80 seconds. Similarly, we will calculate the delta 2, that is 1718.9 into C2 by R. Here we know that C2 is equivalent to 20 meter, that is back interval, and this is also equivalent to C3, this is also equivalent to C4. So this delta 2 will be equivalent to delta 3, this will be equivalent to delta 4, and we will get this deflection angle as 343.78 seconds. If I convert this, I will get it as 5 minutes 43.78 seconds. Now I will calculate the del 5, this will be 1718.9 into Cn by R. This Cn will be nothing but to C5, which is equivalent to 0.34 meter. If I calculate this, I will get the del 5, this del 5 will be 5.84 seconds. Corresponding to this, we have to calculate the delta 1. The delta 1 will be nothing but this will be equal to del 1. This is what we got the del 1 as 42.80 seconds. We have to calculate the delta 2. Delta 2 will be del 1 plus del 2. Del 1 we have got as 42.80 seconds, while the del 2 was 5 minutes 43.48 seconds. We have to take the addition of 4. That will give us delta 2. So delta 2 will be 6 minutes 26.58 seconds. Similarly, we will calculate the delta 3. This will be summation of del 1 plus del 2 plus del 3. So this will be 12 minutes 10.36 seconds. Similarly, we have to calculate the del 4, that is del 1 plus del 2 plus del 3 plus del 4. This will be 17 minutes 54.14 seconds. Similarly, we have to calculate the delta 5. This will be the del 1 plus del 2 plus del 3 plus del 4 plus del 5. This is nothing but your delta 4. Similarly, this was nothing but delta 3. This was nothing but delta 2. So by taking this, we can calculate the delta 5. This delta 5 will be 17 minutes 59.99 seconds. We can write it almost equivalent to 30 minutes. So this is setting of simple circular curve. We have to find out these parameters for setting a simple circular curve using Rankine method. Now we will switch to the transition curve. Now we will learn about the transition curve. First of all, what is the transition curve? We introduce the transition curve before and after the simple circular curve to avoid the sudden jerk to the vehicle. What is that? You must understand this concept. First of all, we will understand with the taking an example of simple circular curve. It is a simple circular curve whose radius is r. Fine. A vehicle let's take an a vehicle which is negotiating on this. This is straight portion. After this, this is a circular curve, and again it's a straight portion. Okay, when a vehicle is negotiating on this straight, the radius of the straight is what? How much is the radius of the straight? The radius of the straight portion is infinite. Fine. The radius of any straight section is nothing but infinite. So once a vehicle is traveling on this straight section up to this point, on this point the radius is equivalent to infinity. But as soon as that vehicle will start negotiating on this simple circular curve, that is this one, on this simple circular curve, the radius is equivalent to r is equal to r. The radius is r. So means up to this point, this is the what? This is the point of curvature. This is t1. Up to this point t1, the vehicle is negotiating on a straight, and the radius of the straight is nothing but infinite. But as in the x, another fraction of second, as soon as he enters from this point to this point, the radius of he comes on a simple circular curve, then the radius on this simple circular curve is equivalent to r. So at this point, the t1, what is happening at this point t1? At this point t1, immediately the radius is changing from infinite to r. The radius at this point t1, the radius is changing immediately from the infinity to r. So what is happening? There is a sudden change in the radius. There is sudden change in radius from the point infinity to the point r. So what will happen? This will produce a sudden change in the radial acceleration. When a vehicle is negotiating on this straight section, the radial acceleration is zero, isn't it? Because on a straight section, the radius is nothing but the infinity. As on a straight section, the radius is infinity, therefore the radial acceleration will be infinite. And on this, when a vehicle will be negotiating on this simple circular curve, then that radial acceleration will be at some particular value, isn't it? Because it has the radius equivalent to r. So on a simple circular curve, the radius acceleration will be some particular value. So what is happening here? The radius acceleration, there is also sudden change in radial acceleration from the value 0 to a particular value. As there is change in radius, there is also change in radial acceleration. So this sudden change in radial acceleration from the 0 to a particular value will cause a sudden jerk to the vehicle, and it will cause and it will produce a discomfort situation for the passenger, which can cause the overturn of the vehicle also, and it will also produce so many kind of other discomfort situations. So in order to avoid this sudden jerk to the vehicle, or to say this, to avoid this discomfort situation, we introduce a transition curve. So this, what will the transition curve will do? This transition curve will help us in a gradual changing of the radius from infinity to r. This will bring a gradual change in the radius from the infinity to r. Here what is happening? At just a point before the radius infinity, at next point the radius is r. So there is sudden change in radial acceleration. So what the transition curve will do? This will produce a gradual change in the radius. This will bring a gradual change in radius from the infinity to r. And hence there will be a gradual change in radius acceleration from 0 to a particular value, so that we can avoid the sudden jerk in the vehicle. That is what the main purpose of providing the transition curve. Generally, we provide this transition curve before the beginning of simple circular curve as well as after ending of simple circular curve. So this will be one transition curve, and this will be a transition curve, and the radius of this curve at this point, the radius will be equivalent to infinite, where at this point the radius of this transition curve will be equivalent to r. Similarly, at this point the radius of curve will be equivalent to the radius of circular curve, while at this point the radius will be inclined to infinite. So now let's discuss the function of this transition curve. We have certain functions. First one, to introduce the gradual centrifugal force between the point of between the tangent point and the beginning of simple circular curve to avoid the sudden jerk of the vehicle. This is what we have discussed. As we are saying, this is the point, tangent point, this is the curvature point, this is the tangent point. So as the radius on this, the radius is infinite. Here it will be radius equal to r. So as it will immediately change from infinity to r, there will be sudden change in radius. So there will be sudden change in radius acceleration. So due to this, there will be certain centrifugal force. So what it is doing, it is we introduce a transition curve at this point, as well as we introduce a transition curve on this side. So what it is doing? It is allowing the gradual change in radiation, gradual change in radius of curve. Therefore, there will be gradual change in centrifugal force at this point, and therefore, it will avoid the sudden jerk to the vehicle. Then, to enable the driver turn the steering gradually for his own comfort and security. If there will be a sudden change in radial acceleration from zero to a particular value, what will happen? The vehicle may overturn. So, as it will provide this gradual change in radial acceleration also, the security and comfort will also increase. Then, to enable the gradual introduction of the design, super elevation and extra winding of the pavement to at the start of simple circular curve, and as well as this also includes the aesthetic appearance of the curve. So what we expect from a transition curve, we expect some of the requirements from the ideal transition curve. So these are some of the requirements what we expect from an ideal transition curve. What are those? It should be tangential to the straight as well as to the circular curve. They should be tangential to the straight as well as to the circular curve. The curvature of an ideal transition curve should be zero. As it is on the straight, there will be the radius will be infinity, and hence the curvature should be equal to zero. The radius of an ideal transition curve at the junction of the circular curve should be same as that of circular curve. Then the length of ideal transition curve should be such that the required superelevation is attained at its junction with the circular curve, and the rate of increase of the curvature along the ideal transition curve should be same as that of super elevation. So these are some of the requirements what we expect from the ideal transition curve. We have three types of transition curve. One is spiral, second is lemniscate, and the third is cubic parabola. This spiral curve is also known as clothoid. There are three curves, the spiral curve, Leibniz curve and cubic parabola. This is 45 degree. Here the point we should remember that up to a deflection angle of 4 degree, all the three curves, that is spiral curve, Leibniz curve and the cubic spiral cubic parabola follows the same path. Up to a deflection angle of 4 degree, all the three curves follow almost the same path, that is spiral, Leibniz curve, cubic parabola. Even though up to a deflection angle of 9 degree, there is not a significant change in the path of these. Up to a deflection angle of 9 degree, there is not even significant change in the path of these, so that is spiral, Leibniz curve and cubic parabola. For a given cubic parabola, but what is the one of the condition of transition curve? That the length of the transition curve should be inversely proportional of the radius of simple circular curve, and as well as that is ls dot r, this must be equal to the constant. Here this these are two points which are these are two points that up to a deflection angle of 4 degree all the three curves follows almost the same path. Even up to a deflection angle of 9 degree, there is not a significant change in the path of all these three. Even though in all the three curves, the length of transition curve varies, the length of the transition curve varies as the radius decreases, means there will be variation in the radius from the infinity to the r. So the length of the transition curve varies as there is change in the radius, or as there is reduction in the radius. But the rate of change of centrifugal force is not uniform in case of the Leibniz curve and the parabola. They are following these two conditions, as well as in all the three, the length of the transition curve increases as the length of radius decreases, but there is not a uniform change in centrifugal force in case of the Leibniz curve and the cubical parabola. But in case of the spiral curve, the length of transition curve increases as there is reduction in the radiation, as well as there is also a uniform change in the centrifugal force, and hence that is it is following the condition that is ls r equals to constant also, as well as the centrifugal force change in centrifugal force, that is change in radial acceleration, is also uniform. So it satisfies all the requirements of a ideal transition curve. Hence the spiral curve, that is a clothoid, is called ideal transition curve. Now we try to calculate the length of the transition curve. Definite rate of superelevation is given, then the length of transition curve can be calculated as nh by 100, where h is nothing but amount of superelevation this we have to take in centimeter, while 1 in n is the rate of superelevation. So this is what, if the definite rate of superelevation is given, that is the amount of superelevation, and 1 in n, that is rate of superelevation is given, then the length of transition curve can be calculated using the formula, that is l equals to nh by 100. then we have S2 arbitrary rate of superelevation. This will be given in generally centimeter per second. If this is, then the length of formula L will be VH by X, where H is nothing but amount of superelevation, V is the speed of vehicle in meter per second, X is rate of attaining super elevation in generally centimeter per second. So if this is this argument, then we can calculate the length of centrifugal using the formula that L equals to VH by X, where H is nothing but the amount of super elevation in centimeter, V is the speed of the vehicle in meter per second, and X is the rate of attaining super elevation in centimeter per second. We will keep these values in centimeter, meter per second, centimeter per second, then we will get the length in meters. These are the empirical formulas. Here we can use the formula, that is L equals to V cube divided by R C. Where V is speed of vehicle in meter per second, R is nothing but the radius of curve. And C is change in radial acceleration. This we keep generally in meter per second square. This radius must be in meter, then the length of curve will be in meter. So there are three cases using the definite rate of superelevation by using arbitrary rate of super elevation, and then last one, that is definite change in radial acceleration. By these three cases, we can calculate the length of transition curve. Now let's solve some of the numericals on this and try to understand these concepts. This is one of the first problem. What we have asked? Calculate the length of transition curve to be introduced between a straight and a curve such that the 15 cm of super elevation will be introduced. So first of all, we will write what is given data. What is given is the rate of super elevation, that is 15 cm of super elevation is introduced. So the amount of super elevation is given to us, that is 15 cm given to us. Then assume the rate of super elevation is 1 in 500. So the rate of super elevation is given. So what is n? Small n. This small n is given as 500. So here we can use the formula for calculating the length of transition curve, that is L equals to nh by 100. There the n is also given and h amount of super elevation is also given. So we can calculate the length of transition curve easily. So what is n is given as 500, h is given as 15 cm. These are the empirical formula. We have to keep the value of h in cm. This is 100. If we solve this, we will get the length of transition curve as 75 meters. Just simple formula based numericals. What we have done? The amount of superelevation was given as well as the rate of superelevation was given, and we were asked to calculate the length of transition curve. We use the formula directly, that is L equals to n is 500, n is 500, and h is 15 cm. By putting the values, we got the length of transition curve. Let's move to the next numerical. What is given here? First of all, let's read the problem. We are asked to calculate the length of transition curve to be inserted between a straight and a curve such that 15 cm superelevation may be attained. Means, first of all, that amount of superelevation that it has equals to 15 cm is given. Then, assume the rate of attaining superelevation as 2.5 cm per second. That is, x is given, rate of attaining superelevation as 2.5 cm per second. Then the last parameter is given, that is speed of the vehicle, is given as v equals to 60 km/h. So we can calculate this v into, we have to calculate into meter per second. So by multiplying 5 by 18, we can get it into meter per second. How we got? For km/h, kilometer, this is 1000 meter divided by, this is 3600 this second. If we calculate this, this will be nothing but the 5 by 18. So directly we are using the factor 5 by 18 for converting the velocity from km/h to meter per second. Then we know the formula that the length of transition curve is nothing but vh divided by x. All things are given, v is given, h is given, x is given. What is v? V is nothing but 60 into 5 by 18, where h is nothing but 15 cm. And x is given, rate of attaining superelevation as 2.5. If we solve this, we will get the length of transition curve as 100 meters. This is the length of transition curve. You have to remember about the unit that here you have to convert this v in meter per second. Let's see one more type. For example, the maximum allowable speed on the curve is 80 km/h, that means v is given as 80 km/h. The rate, radial acceleration, that is t, is given as 30 cm/s². And the radius of circular curve is given as 200 m. First of all, we will change the v, that is speed in meter per second. So we will write as 80 into 5 by 18, this is meter per second. Similarly, we will try to get the rate of change in radial acceleration meter per second. So this 30 cm/s², I want to convert it into meter per second square. So 30 divided by 100 equals to 0.3 meter per second square. Now we know the length of transition curve is nothing but v cube divided by rc, where v is 80 into 5 by 80, this is the velocity, cube divided by r is 200, that is radius, into c is rate of change in radial acceleration, that is 0.3. If we calculate it, we will get the length of transition curve, this as 182.9 meter. So this is the length of transition curve. So we have learned about in today's lecture the calculation of parameters for setting simple circular curve using Cole-Pewdiepie method as well as using Rankine method. Then we successfully transition curve. We learned what is transition curve, what is the importance of this, the function of transition curve. We have learned about the requirement of an ideal transition curve. Then we have learned the ideal shape of transition curve, various types of transition curve, how to calculate the length of transition curve, and we have learned some of the formulas, some of the numericals for calculating the length of transition curve. Thank you.